Okay, there are that, we have two types of problems, right? Type one, case one, case two. Case one, equilibrium is stated explicitly, if it is, you know, if that's the case. In this one, equilibrium, okay, is unclear. In this case, what it means, the force of friction is this mu, which is this coefficient of static friction, times the vertical reaction force. Here, you need to find from equilibrium equations, and then compare with the maximum force of friction. That's the only difference between these two cases. But for both of them, you simply draw the free body diagrams from each individual free body diagram. Find those unknowns that you need, not necessarily all the unknowns, as you do in the case of frames, as many of them as you need to find the question that the problem is asking you, or the unknown that the problem wants you to find. And that's it. So that's it. So I did a few problems, both case one, and I think I did one case two. I'm just gonna do more, okay? And we'll probably do more on Wednesday, and some review of the course. You're almost there, can you believe that? You have put up with me for 10 weeks almost. Yes.
On the final, how many questions will there be?
Either five or six, good question, because I forgot to say that. One question, one or two would be on trusses. So review trusses thoroughly. One on frames and machines, one on moment of inertia, one on friction, and one on three D rigid body equilibrium, or sometimes I've given a bunch of, say, frames or whatnot, and have asked just draw the free body diagram. So I'm just debating between those two options. So either that, as far as the problem number five, or a 3D rigid body equilibrium. Yes?
And for the moment of inertia, will that be complex shape?
No, just come, yes, come, no integrals, no, no. Any other questions? Okay.
I missed one of those. I have trusses, frames, moment of inertia, free body equilibrium,
and friction. Friction. So let's do a few problems. I know I did three or four problems, so I'm going to start with this problem. So this is a case one problem again. And it's like this. You do have a mechanism that is used to drive this system. So it's a mechanical system used to, if you apply a force, F can move this piece up and down along this rod. This is color, basically, okay? So you want to find out if this force is 100 Newton applied force, and there is no friction on these two surfaces where this box or piston or whatever it is moves, and this bar, of course, is pinned at both ends to these two pieces. You want to find out how much force you need to apply here downward, okay, to keep this from moving, or in other words, keep this in equilibrium or in no motion. The coefficient of friction between this and the rod is also given. So you want to find that force P that would keep this in place. Obviously, if this is pushing that, and you have then applied load P, what direction do you think this may go? Either up or down, depending on if the magnitude of this. So you want to find the minimum P that is required to keep this in place, right? So again, basically you just draw the free body diagram, right? The second step is you have been told this is in equilibrium, right? You don't want this system to move, or the applied load is such that keeps this in equilibrium. Therefore, this is not gonna move, it's in equilibrium, so it's case one. Draw the free body diagram of both pieces. So you have this block subjected to 100 Newton force. This is a two force member, so the force of FAB from this rod acting on this, and then you have a vertical force NA. That's the free body diagram of piece one. Then you have this, obviously, this rod, because it's a two force member, and then this moving part that is subjected to force P. And if this is going to go up, then the force of friction is going to be down, right? If it goes up. If it's gonna go down, that means motion is in this direction, so the force of friction, F of F, would be like that. But this is the same force, FAB, FAB. Then, of course, you have also this force N at B, vertical force. Okay. So there are these two possibilities if this goes down. Okay. Any questions? So you have these two free body diagrams, or three free body diagrams. So you start with a free body diagram with minimum number of unknowns to find the unknowns that you want. And as I had emphasized, the difference between friction problem and typical frame problem is that you don't necessarily find all the unknowns from this free body diagram. You need to find only those that you would help you to find the actual unknown that you're looking for. So in this free body diagram, the only unknown that comes into this picture from this free body diagram is this. So all I need to find is just this unknown. So I use that free body diagram, if I call it one, okay? I can just simply write summation of forces along x is equal to zero. By the way, this was given as 60 degrees, right? Yes. So you have a 100, minus FAB cosine 60 is equal to zero. This is 1/2, so F of AB is 200 Newton. Do I need to find this force? No. If you want to find it, go ahead, but you're basically wasting your time. So let's move to second free body diagram. Now that I have F of AB, I can write summation of forces along x is equal to zero. So I have F of AB, which is 200 times cosine of 60. Okay, again, minus NB is equal to zero. So NB is 100 Newton. Now, we know F of F, since this is in equilibrium, is we want it to stay in equilibrium, is simply mu S times NB. So it would be 0.2 times 100, or is 20 Newton. So if I write summation of forces along Y, is equal to zero, I get negative P, negative 20, okay, plus 100 cosine of 30 is equal to zero.
That's 200.
Which one? F of AB, oh, it's 200, right? So that'll be 100 times 174, 150, almost 154. Okay. You can use the other free body diagram and you can see that in that case, in fact, P would be larger than this. So that's the minimum. So, any questions? Easy. Yes?
Why do you use cosine 30, not cosine
60? That's for y, right? I think this was 60, so this is 30. Am I right? Yeah, cosine. Any other questions? Okay, let's do another problem. I have quite a few good problems. This time. Okay. So let's see. This is a case two problem now. We had a crate sitting on this rough surface. It weighs, or the mass of that is 150 kilogram. A cable is attached to it. And this guy wants to pull this let's say this is the wonderful drawing. Okay. So we know the coefficient of friction between this guy's shoes and this ground, coefficient of friction that we call this point. M, this I call that point C. Coefficient of friction between the guy's shoes and the floor is 0.4. And the coefficient of friction here is 0.3. And the guy also weighs, has a mass, obviously, that is 80 kilograms. So we want to know if this guy is going to pull that crate, given this condition, this guy is going to slip or he's safe, he's not going to slip. So the minute, you know, actually the statement of the problem is determine if the man can move the crate. So in order for him to move the crate, what is the condition that should be satisfied? Right? That means he's pulling it, right? So the maximum force that is resisting the motion is the friction force, right? Here. And it is that friction force that this guy should basically overcome. So in other words, the crate is assumed to be in equilibrium with the maximum force, which is mu s times n, acting on that. And we want to know if that causes this guy to slip or resisting this man enough to basically not being allowed to put this instead, he's gonna slip this way or not. But we do see that if this guy slipped, the slippage would be obviously that way, right? Gonna move in that direction. So let's look at that. So with that said, again, the tools we have is simply draw the free body diagrams, right? That's it. So we have this crate. It is subjected to this guy's force. And by the way, this angle is also given at 30 degrees. So if this is pulling it, the crate potentially moves that way, so the force of friction at C, which is mu times N, C, and N, C being the vertical force, is given, right? And this is 30 degrees. The man himself, if we can draw his schematic better, right? So this is his shoes, okay? If it's going to slip, would it slip this way? So the force of friction at the bottom of his shoes, or F of M, okay, is this way. There will be, of course, a vertical force, this force P, and then the guy also has a weight. Let's use G as 10 meter per second squared. So the weight of this guy then would be 800 Newton, and this would be the weight here, would be 1500 Newton. Okay, so this is 1500 Newton. So we have two free body diagrams. This one is in equilibrium. This one we have to verify the equilibrium. So I would use free body diagram number one, which is going to give me what? Writing a summation of forces along y is equal to zero will give me n sub c minus 1500 plus, actually I should do this, p cosine of 60 is equal to zero, one half, and then summation of forces along x is equal to zero will give me p cosine of 30, which is square root of 3 over 2, minus f sub c, which is 0.3 times n sub c, is equal to 0. So we have two equations and two unknowns. I can find both p and f. I will get p will be equal to 434.5 Newton. I don't care about N sub C. I don't need it, because that's the only unknown that comes into play in this free body diagram. You're welcome to find N sub C again. You don't need to. Let's save some time here. So I will move to free body diagram two. In free body diagram two, I write summation of forces along X is equal to zero. That will give me, this is again, okay, this is 30 degrees, right? So summation of forces along x equal to zero will give me 434.5 cosine of 30, again, square root 3 over 2, okay? Minus f of m is equal to zero. So f of m comes out to be 376.3 Newton. If you summation of forces along y equal to zero, you get negative 800 plus n sub m minus p 434.5 cosine of 60, which is one half, is equal to zero. And that will give you n sub m, which is equal to 1,002 Newton. So this is the friction force that develops as a result of this guy pulling this rope, right? How much is the maximum friction force that as a result of the kind of shoes he's wearing, or the coefficient of friction that those shoes have and the ground, will be generated? That is, if I call that F sub S, which is the maximum force, that would be 0.4 times Nm, and that would be 100.8. Newton. So as this guy is pulling, right, the force that he's generating is this much, right? Which is less than the maximum friction force that is resisting his slippage. So is this guy going to be safe or not? He's gonna be sound and safe. So this guy is not going to slip. He's wearing good shoes, okay? Any questions? Again, I emphasize, just follow the logic, right? That draw the free body diagram, think about or really understand the problem statement to detect whether equilibrium exists or you need to verify equilibrium. That's it. Okay. Any questions? I'll do another one. I have a good one for you. I could not, in fact, finish this problem in the other section, and I promised them that I will finish it here so they will get to see the answer on the videos. So let's do it. This was in fact an exam problem. So it gives you an idea about the level of simplicity or the complexity or the whatever of the type of problem you can expect. I think that piston problem what used to be also an exam problem. But this is how this problem is, or the problem statement is stated. You want to demonstrate the concept of friction. So you're very creative, come up with this idea that you take a box or something, you know, a heavy box, which weighs, that's not that heavy actually, only 3 kilograms, okay? W1 is 3 kilograms times g, okay? That you put it on the floor and the coefficient of friction between this and the floor is given. Mu sub a is 0.4. The width of this is, in fact, 0.2 or is 0.1, 0.1, if that is the center of gravity of this box. Then you put a rod over this box, and which is laying against this wall, laying on this box. The coefficient of friction here between the rod and the top of the box is 0.6. This rod has a weight, call that W2, which is 6 kilograms times g. And the coefficient of friction between the rod and the wall is also given 0.3. And this distance is 0.8 meters. You have this distance between the point of contact of the rod and top of the box and the wall, that is 0.6 meters. And the problem statement is this. Can you apply a moment, M, to this rod in such a way that the magnitude of that M is such that this rod experiences no slippage at point C? And in other words, no movement takes place here. Okay. If that's the case, find the value of M. That's the only information that is given. All we know that if you apply this moment, no slippage takes place here. But we don't know if any motion takes place here or here. Between rod relative to the box or the box relative to the ground. Okay? May sound a little bit different or complicated, but at least you can see the part of the problem is not giving you explicitly if the equilibrium exists, right? So you have, this is the second type, problem of type two. Nevertheless, you just draw the free body diagram, right? So let's first look at this bar. We know no slippage takes place here, but if this is going to move due to this action, it would go down, potentially goes down. So the force of friction here, which would be point mu times N at C, okay, would be upward, right? And of course, you have the weight of this rod. Let's again take G, 10 meter per second squared. So this would be 60 Newton. You have the supplied moment. So if this is going to go down, or go down against, of course, this wall, it's going to move this way, right? So if this is going to move this way, there's a friction between that and top of the box. And this is moving this way, the friction force that would develop on this bar at point B would be this way. And then you have, of course, a reaction force like this, right? So that's a free body diagram of this bar. Okay, you see in the frames, you didn't have to care about direction of these forces, but in friction, that's actually the key. You need to detect or understand which direction potentially the motion may be and choose these properly. So if that's the case now, this is free body diagram one, this is free body diagram two. So if that's the force of friction between the box and this rod acting on the box, on the rod in that direction, then on the box, this force of friction would be that way, right? You have the weight of the box, which is 30 Newton. You have this vertical force N at A, but what direction this would be, the potential friction force between here and the floor? The only force that potentially is moving this block is this force, right? So if the force is acting that way, what direction this block potentially would move? This way, right?
Yes.
You're pushing it.
Yeah.
Right? So the force of friction that is resisting it at A would be this way. Okay? So you can see some of these problems like this, understanding or thinking about this direction of the friction force based on potential direction of motion is really critical. You know, that you really understand this. Any questions? Yes.
How come we're not accounting for the weight of the bar on the box?
The bar? The weight of the bar is not acting on the box. The only, you like, frames, you know, the connection between these two is at this point, right? So you have two forces, right, acting here, and the opposite forces acting that way. Actually, is one thing that I forgot to put here, maybe that's what you meant, was NB, right? Is that what you meant?
Yeah.
You were correct. So I just put the weight and did not put that one. Okay, now we have everything we need to know. So just consider each free body diagram, apply equations of equilibrium. So I'm going to consider the first one. Right, summation of forces along X is equal to zero. So from there, I do see that F of B minus NC are the only two forces come to picture equal to zero, so I get F of B is equal to N C. The second equation of equilibrium, summation of forces along Y is equal to zero. So I have N B plus F C, which is, since this, we set this no slip, it's here, which is 0.3 and C minus 60 is equal to zero. So this gives me another equation, right? And then I can take summation of moments at point B is equal to zero. So I have M, which is positive, plus 60 times this distance, which has been given, okay, because we were given that this, the middle of the bar actually, this distance, yeah, this is 0.6, so this would be 0.3, okay? So 0.3 plus 0.1, so that would be 0.4. So that would be plus 60 times, can you see that? This is, I'm taking summation of moments about point B. So this is 0.3, right? So it would be 60 times 0.3, that moment, and then you have this one, so it would be, oh, these actually would be, both of them would be negative, right? So this is negative, and this is negative, because you're clockwise. Then you have plus F of C times this distance, 0.6, okay? And then you have also MC times 0.8 is equal to zero. So these are the equations that I get. Maybe I should simplify them, would be better, right? So let's write the three equations from that we got from equations of equilibrium in that free body diagram. So let's write them neat and nicely. F of B is equal to NC, right? The second one, NB plus 0.3 NC is equal to 60. And this one, I have FC, okay, which is actually, again, I would write that down because FC is 0.3 and C, so at 0.3 and C would be 0.18. So it would be 0.18 and C minus M, okay, plus 0.8, so that'll be 0.98 and C, okay, is equal to 18. I hope I have simplified these correctly. So these are the three questions that I have from free body diagram number one. So let's move now to free body diagram number two, right? Let me call this point O. So I can write summation of forces along x is equal to zero. I get minus F of B plus F of A is equal to zero, or F of A is equal to F of B. Okay? Summation of forces along y is equal to zero. So I get NB, or negative NB, plus NA, okay, NB minus NA minus 30 is equal to zero, okay, or is equal to 30, okay? So that's from this equation, okay? And then I have, let me confirm those, because I have all these results, okay? So I have NB minus NA minus NB, okay? So the last equation I have is summation of moments. So I will write summation of moments. Take summation of moments about point O is equal to zero. This point, I have these distances. So if I take summation of moments, this doesn't show up. I will have just NA times point one positive. Also FB times that height. That we have that height. I forgot to give you that height. FB would be time point, that is a point three also. Okay, FB, this is also point three. So I have plus FB, okay, times positive FB also times point three, okay. Then I have only this one, which would be positive, so negative. So I have N B times 0.1, then minus 30 times 0.1 is equal to zero. So that's the other equation. So you can solve for all of these. I mean, you have same, you know, basically the adequate number of equations to find all the unknowns. If you solve for the unknowns that you need, FB, actually M comes out to be 8.561 Newton meter. NB comes out to be 51 Newton, and NA will come out as 80 Newton, and FA and FB, which are equal, is equal to also NC, would be 27 Newton. All these are all the unknowns. Okay. Now the question is, the problem, the statement was, how much should be this moment that would not cause basically any motion? It keeps this in equilibrium, right? So these are the friction forces that are required, or we derive based on the assumption that the system was in equilibrium, but we have to confirm that, right? At point B, the maximum friction force that basically resists that motion, or F at B, right, due to friction, maximum, is the coefficient of friction, 0.6 times NB. So that will give us 31 Newton. Okay? And this FB is what? 27. That we assumed based on the equilibrium. This is 27 is less than 31. So cannot overcome that force. That means no motion takes place between the rod and the top of the box, right? How about at the bottom? Do you think there's any motion is going to develop between the box and the floor? Let's figure that out. This is the force of friction that develops based on the assumption of equilibrium. Let's see if you're violating that or not. So the force of friction at A, or the maximum force of friction that develops, is mu at A, given as 0.4, right, times N at A. And that gives us equal to 32.11, right? Again, F at A, right? Or, which is 27, is less than 32.11. right? So no motion takes place at that point either. It's fun, right? It's different, you know, friction problems are equilibrium problems, but require some philosophical discussions, right? Okay, so see you on Wednesday, hopefully.